Christopher Columbus landed first in the New World at the island of San Salvador, and after praising God, inquired urgently for gold. The natives, Red Indians, were peaceable and friendly and directed him to Haiti, a large island, nearly as large as Ireland, rich, they said, in the yellow metal. He sailed to Haiti. One of his ships being wrecked, the Haitian Indians helped him so willingly that very little was lost, and of the articles which they brought on shore, not one was stolen. The Spaniards, the most advanced Europeans of their day, annexed the island, called it Hispaniola, and took the backward natives under their protection. They introduced Christianity, forced labor in mines, murder, rape, bloodhounds, strange diseases, and artificial famine by the destruction of cultivation to starve the rebellious. These and other requirements of the higher civilization reduced the native population from an estimated 500,000, perhaps 1,000,000, to 60,000 in 15 years.
And thus it is that Dr. C.L.R. James, a very distinguished scholar, reads the first two paragraphs of his prologue, a remarkable book, a classic, The Black Jacobins, which deals with the Toussaint L'Ouverture-led black slave rebellion in San Domingo 2 years after the French Revolution. In these two paragraphs, Dr. James, your style of writing, of course, is a very salubrious one indeed, but the bite, the irony, and the truth, you might say, of white man and all these years, of Western civilization, so-called, in these two paragraphs, you've almost essentialized it.
Yes, I think so, and I wrote it quite naturally. I didn't have to search, but I am a West Indian, and we in the West Indies are very much aware of the contrast between what the white man says and what he does, because we are Western civilized in our orientation, so we are aware of all the things he's saying, much more than people who speak a different language or live a different type of civilization.
This very point you make, which you point out, Professor James is now visiting the professor at the Northwestern University. The fact that you're West Indian, this has always been a fascinating historical point, isn't it?
We think
among the leaders and the whole black liberation movement through the years have been West Indians.
Yes, we have had a whole lot of them. We have had Marcus Garvey. We have had Aimé Césaire, the poet, with that magnificent poem on Africa in which he stated the question of negritude. We have had René Marin, who won the Prix Goncourt with the book Batuala on Africa. We have had
George Padmore,
Marcus Garvey, as I said. And we have had, there's no doubt about it, that Malcolm X's mother was a West Indian, and that had something to do with it. And Stokely Carmichael was born and grew up there as a boy. I also took some part. I believe it is something that is worthwhile. And I know and feel myself as a West Indian as Padmore was.
It's as though two cultures are fused, in a sense.
Yes, we are not admitted completely into the Western culture, but we have all the possibilities of developing it. So on being kept back at home, we went abroad and made the best use of both the opportunities of education and the impulse towards freedom, which we felt in the islands. That is the reason why the West Indians have done so well. And I would like to add this, that Fidel Castro and the Cubans are not all black people. Fidel isn't black at all. But the attitude of the revolution and what they are doing is essentially a West Indian revolution, similar to what Toussaint L'Ouverture did.
Yes, so we come, in fact, you have an appendix to your book, an epilogue. You wrote the book in 1938, how remarkably prescient and prophetic Professor James' book is, because he dealt with the nature of Africa and the possible independence movements back then. But the epilogue is from Toussaint L'Ouverture to Castro. Now, Toussaint L'Ouverture, and it's imperative, of course, that white people know this. More blacks do, or we know that younger blacks are aware of this. I had difficulty finding this book, by the way, in white bookstores. I found it at the Ellis Bookshop on South Cottage, which is significant in itself, I think.
I think the book now is being sold and read everywhere.
Yes.
I think the movement on the whole, it is being read and studied in universities predominantly white in the United States. That is a fact. Although it's the black movement that has given it the great impetus.
Perhaps we should dwell upon the nature of this book, and it's a terribly important one. It's the Black Jacobins, the subtitle, Toussaint L'Ouverture and the San Domingo Revolution. Now, here you describe a scene of the Spaniards came, the French, the British. They found a great deal of profit to be made in the West Indies, San Domingo, Haiti. And
it now, was the wealthiest colony in the world at the time, not only in the West Indies.
And so, but it could only be done. You describe, of course, the slave trade and the nature of the slave ships and the incredible brutishness. So the question is, how could a people, the black people in this case, the Africans, and this, well, I'll ask you about the mulattoes in a moment, the Creoles, how could they survive is the question. This is the key.
The question is this. Number one, they were a people, obviously, who had basically a very fine physique. Otherwise, they would have been wiped away by the sheer objective circumstances of the Middle Passage and their lives. They had a fine physique, and secondly, which is a most important point, they obviously were a highly civilized people. Otherwise, they wouldn't have been able to be integrated into the sugar production in the way that they were and learn as rapidly as they did the language and all the techniques of Western civilization. They were a civilized people in Africa, and today people are more and more recognizing that even when they were slaves in Africa, they were slaves of a certain organized society. That is what must be remembered about the West Indian. And he was more fortunate than he was in the United States because the islands were small, immensely concentrated. The sugar plantation had many of them living together, so they were closely connected. And this backbone of civilization in Africa and African physical strength, and then having to learn the elements of Western civilization, made them what they did and what they have become.
So we come to several points that Dr. James raises, and again, the question of submerged history or suppressed history, that there was a highly developed, and Basil Davidson, among others, points
this out. Basil Davidson is doing a lot of that work, and that work is very important, and I'm very glad that Basil Davidson is doing it, because I have to say there is a tendency to criticism, sharp criticism of people who are whites because they are white. And Basil Davidson is a white man who would be an adornment to any black university.
But in his books, whether it be The Lost Cities of Africa, others, he speaks, and indeed many anthropologists now are discovering it, there was a highly developed civilization before the slave ships came.
Yes, not only that, the man who I know has carried that to the highest point is Professor George Roig. He used to be at Rochester, and he's now professor of sociology at Washington University in St. Louis. And he's doing some work on that subject, which is the very finest and most developed that I know. I myself am writing something, and most of my work is based not only on previous knowledge, but on what he and I have worked out together.
Before I ask you further about the book, we go into the book, we should point out to the audience that Professor James is a historic figure. I hope you don't mind my saying this. He's not a museum. Professor James was an acquaintance of Nkrumah. He had met him when you discovered him, when he was going to the University of Pennsylvania. He was a friend of Dr. Du Bois. He was a friend of George Padmore, a remarkable figure, too little known. Well,
a close ally of George Padmore. I used to know Marcus Garvey, too.
You knew Marcus Garvey.
Marcus Garvey came to Trinidad sometime about 1928. He had already been sent away from the United States. And I was a reporter, and I went and interviewed him and followed him around where he spoke. He was a tremendous man.
You probably are one of the few living people, I would guess, who knew Marcus Garvey personally.
Yes, I knew Marcus Garvey. I interviewed him somewhere about 1928.
Perhaps this is worth dwelling on, the role of Marcus Garvey. Here's a man who's been ridiculed to a great extent, and yet he made people aware, did he not, this West Indian.
I believe the intellectual origin of the black movement must rest with Dr. Du Bois. A man with a range of scholarship, practical activity, and ambition for the development of humanity, which is not exceeded by anybody in the 20th century. But his chief concern was to appeal to and get in contact with intellectuals, historians, organizers, etc. When Du Bois was finished, Garvey began, so to speak, and Garvey made black emancipation something popular, which it had never been before. So both of them, although they may have had conflict, they filled political roles. Du Bois made it an intellectual discussion, posed the question, Garvey made it a popular question. When Garvey was finished, everybody knew there was a black question. Both white people knew and black people all over the world knew. And that is what Garvey did, despite the mistakes that he made. That is to his great credit.
And Garvey's name was known throughout the black world. In Africa, too, they knew of Marcus Garvey.
And also throughout the white world. Garvey had made everybody, black and white, understand that the black man was sleeping no longer. He was on his way. That is his great contribution.
Here again, a West Indian. And so we return to this moment that with which your book begins. Here was a colony profitable to the colonists, to the absentee landlords, the powers, people being used, abused, yet surviving. Now, something happened in France. Now, in 1789 was a French Revolution. Therefore, it had a certain impact. How did word come to San Domingo?
For one reason, people used to go up and down, but the French whites discussed the doctrines of the French Revolution with the utmost freedom. And there were white people from France who asked them, aren't you worried a bit that you should discuss these things before these black people? But they paid no attention to the blacks. They looked upon them as some sort of animal. A white woman used to undress before the black slaves as if they were a horse or a dog. They looked upon them as nothing. And they discussed these things very freely. And people from France asked them, but aren't you nerve talking? They didn't bother, but the blacks were listening.
Ah, what is interesting about this, what makes Professor James' book so contemporary, is this very point you just made. Often there is a woman working as a domestic in the home of a white mistress, you know, and she's talked about many, tell me this, friends of mine who worked as domestics, elderly women, who say that they know everything about this person, and the person knows nothing about her because they talk in front of her as though she were furniture.
That is a fact. That is a fact. That is a fact. You see, and a great deal of that is due to the fact that the black man is looked upon as a barbarous African, but he has had to learn the language. That is very important. He has had to learn the European language. So today in the Caribbean, he speaks English, French, or Spanish. And he's equally a master of all of those languages.
He's learned these languages. He's learned far more, indeed, than the white master knew, to survive. And so we come to many other aspects in your book, the nature of survival itself. Sometimes it's clowning. Sometimes it's pretending not to know in order to survive. And behavior different, black people among blacks, different than, say, in front of the white who comes.
That is quite true. But the thing that I emphasize in regard to the Caribbean islands and regard to the San Domingo Revolution and the Cuban Revolution is this. The islands are rather small, judging on a world scale. The population is immensely concentrated. The type of industry where there is some is sugar or scraps of modern industry which develop a highly civilized population. And in, for example, Trinidad, the island I come from, Barbados and Jamaica, we have the extraordinary advantage of having newspapers, papers, television, radio, etc., from Britain, from the United States, and from Canada. The opportunity of being in touch with the advanced centers of civilization is very
good. So
great.
Then the people were au courant with all aspects
the
of life.
People are aware. They just have to pay $2 or $3 a month, and they get a radio, and they hear everything that's going on.
Now, going back to this time, something was happening then at this moment in France, the revolution. 2 years later, something broke out in San Domingo, and we soon learn of a man named Toussaint L'Ouverture. But before that, now, was there an attempt by the colonists to split the people? After all, there were mulattoes, there were Creoles, and there were the blacks.
Yes, the San Domingo Revolution began, the black revolution, because of the fierce struggle that was carried on between the San Domingo whites and the mulattoes who owned property, and some of them were educated. And after seeing the ferocity of that violence, the blacks themselves entered. They entered as a result of the conflict between San Domingo whites and San Domingo mulattoes, in the same way as the masses of France intervened because of the conflict between the nobles, the aristocracy, and the bourgeoisie. This went on, and then the masses came in. The same thing happened in San Domingo.
So a parallel was working both
parallel
ways.
Was working. As a matter of fact, I'm very much struck by the tremendous parallels between the development in San Domingo and the developments in France. Much of my book pays careful attention attention to that, and I believe there are more parallels to be found later as we study both the French Revolution and the San Domingo Revolution.
So there was a question of paradox involved, a question of contradiction involved. You point out the French Revolution was, in a sense, bourgeois.
It was.
Taking over, knocking off the... At the same time, slave trade was part of their...
Yes, the money that the bourgeoisie got that made them what they were, and as Jaurès says, gave them the feeling for liberty, that came from the slave trade. It's a very sharp contradiction. Now, the second paradox that I'm concerned with is that this sugar plantation was a very severe and demanding mode of labor, but it also concentrated the blacks and gave them some element of social civilization, some feeling of unity, and enabled them to learn fundamentally many aspects of Western civilization. So that this sugar plantation was at the same time the most degrading and at the same time a very civilizing effort on the part of the black people.
Again, paradox. The degrading nature of the work, the exploitation, at the same time, communication. Because of the constant contact.
Constant contact, and also the sugar plantation produced sugar, and the food that they ate came from abroad, the sugar was sent abroad, and so forth, so that they had education, not only in what was going on around them and the close relation with their masters, but the sugar plantation was intimately connected with foreign developments and finance and so forth, and all that the slaves learned.
So the window now was being opened. The window, awareness was occurring. And once that happens, people can no longer be the same.
And the moment the French Revolution began, because what is important about the San Domingo Revolution, which has made it the most successful, the only successful slave revolt in history, is the fact that they were slaves. They had these elements of civilization in them, but they were able to use the doctrines and ideas of the French Revolution and apply them, these ideas, to their own situation. So they had not only a physical basis, contact with society, but they had a new ideology. That's what they were, the liberty, equality, fraternity, all that meant to them, the republic, and so on.
So again, perhaps the crowning paradox is the fact that it was the bourgeoisie that were factors in the French Revolution, and also profiting from the slave trade, but because of what they did, the window was now opened to the black slaves as well as the colored slaves.
And they learned they took it over and made it something for themselves.
And so the time was ripe then for a certain figure or group of figures.
Yes, on the basis of that objective development and the spread of ideas, there emerges this remarkable man. It's difficult to say that the revolution made him, but he made the revolution, but the interplay between them is such that it's difficult to distinguish.
And here we come to a man who's been a slave for 45 years,
yes.
Toussaint L'Ouverture.
Yes.
And he comes at this moment, about 1791 or so.
Yes. However, more important is the fact that the Abbé Raynal had written a famous book on the situation in the East and the West Indies. And he had said in that book, in a magnificent gesture, that the time was coming when some revolutionary person would relieve the slaves of the burdens from which they were suffering. And what is most fantastic, that book came into the hands of Toussaint L'Ouverture. And he read repeatedly this passage in which the Abbé Raynal, I'm sure he was just a revolutionary intellectual, he just said, someday somebody would arise. And Toussaint kept on saying, someday somebody should arise. And he kept on thinking that someday somebody should arise. And the moment the revolt started in San Domingo, he said, I am the person now. That is a very strange business.
Now, something was happening in France. You mentioned that Diderot, there were writings against slavery.
That is before the revolution, the encyclopedia, yes.
There were writings, but very often, I think you point this out in the case of Robespierre, that it was the word rather than the deed that was being attacked.
Because to abolish slavery meant a revolution. A tremendous revolution, not only in San Domingo, but in France. And they had reached 1793, and the days of May 1793, and they had reached this spring of 94 before they abolished slavery.
So now the word had come. The man had come, and his colleagues, now the word. Were they, and for 12 years now, the battle raged, the revolution, with pressures back and forth, were the colonists wholly, now we come to the question of awareness or lack of awareness, were the absentee landlords or the colonists themselves?
Now, the colonists began by joining the revolution because the ancient monarchy had what is called the exclusive, and by that means they dominated the economy. So the colonists began by joining the revolution. But afterwards they saw that the revolution in France was assisting the black people and saying, at any rate, if you are fighting for freedom, you should have it, etc. Whereupon the colonists, to a large majority, offered the colony to the British. That they offered it to the British. They were ready to get rid of king and all this loyalty. They told them if slavery was what mattered to them.
Yeah.
And so they offered it to the British, and the British came to get it. But they were defeated by Toussaint L'Ouverture and the Black Army.
So we have here again, we come back to your very opening two paragraphs read in the prologue, the question of the coin, the question of the property, the wealth,
the production, the control of it.
So I think what's bone deeply powerful about Dr. James' book, The Black Jacobins, is it deals with the reality of today, too. Though you deal with a time 100 and almost 200 years ago, and you say that there's lip service very often offered, but until the reality phase that may concern property itself, then a shift occurs in the case of the colonists.
I was able to write this book because I was taking part in London and thereabouts with George Padmore, Jomo Kenyatta, and various others. I had been friendly. I got to know Nkrumah. And we were living this life. In other words, the French Revolution, the Revolution of San Domingo, was to us a forecast of what would take place in Africa. So this book is closely the result of the kind of activity we were carrying on, both with the Marxist movement, with the black movement, and with the Labour Party and various others in Europe. The book is the result of a collaboration of a lot of people.
So it really is a fusion of past and present.
It's a fusion.
So you wrote about the past, writing about present and future.
And if you read the book carefully as you will see that all through I am concerned with the effect of what I am writing on Africa.
Yes.
Yes.
Even have, if we come to another aspect, and this connects with the revolution itself, Toussaint L'Ouverture, voodooism, the very fact that this had to be done secret too, because how could black people be Christians, or to make no sense, equal to the white, the colonists?
They stuck to their voodooism because it formed a secret means of communication. But when the revolution actually took place, Toussaint and his officers were very severe against voodooism. They thought it was a backward being. But undoubtedly, I have no doubt as time goes on, that voodooism, not only before 1791, but afterwards, was a secret means of communication between
just
the
like
Haitians.
The slaves in America, the spiritual had a double meaning,
yes.
So the gatherings.
They were very close to Africa, you see, because many of the slaves who made the revolution had made the Middle Passage. So they had their voodooism. Well, they
now,
had.
A question, because your book raised these questions, which makes it so fascinating a work, too. The role of the French working people, masses now, at the time, the French Revolution and after, what effect this was having on the revolt elsewhere? We naturally think of today, America and Vietnam, in a sense, you see.
No, I think this much. First of all, the French Revolution was a bourgeois revolution in that it resulted in the displacement of the feudal elements by the bourgeoisie, and the bourgeoisie took over. But the fact remains that the bourgeoisie would not have been able to carry that revolution to its success unless the masses of the French people, the sans-culottes, had done it for them. The sans-culottes didn't win manures, but they were so hostile to the regime that they carried the bourgeois revolution to its complete end. And also in San Domingo, the revolt there meant that the black soldiers were able to defend that wealthy colony against the British, Spaniards, and the rest of them, so that they helped one another. And at the high peak of the revolution in France, that was the time when the French revolutionary forces declared freedom for blacks everywhere. So the two of them were working together.
Now, were there attempts, I think you point this out in your books too, there was a great ambivalence on the part of mulattoes to many, many cases.
Yes, the mulattoes were an intermediate class. It has nothing to do with their color or their blood or the mixture of blood. It is that they were not closely allied with the rich whites, but they were rich people, and they were allied in a way with the blacks. They were partially British or black. So in between there, they were a typical intermediate class and wobbled both sides. Now they would go with this one and the other. And the ultimate victory in San Domingo was won when the mulattoes joined completely with the blacks to finish up with the French invasion.
Now we come to several people in Toussaint's life. You mentioned Abbé Raynal and a remarkable man named Santonax.
Santonax was a Jacobin. He was a right-wing Jacobin. But there was something about him. He came out to San Domingo, being sent by the government more than once. And although he made mistakes and things and so forth, he was a man completely devoted to the emancipation of the black people. And he taught them literacy. He taught them revolutionary songs. He taught them Latin and Greek stories and education, the doctrines of the revolution. And he told them, you have your guns, keep them. If at any time anybody tells you to give up your guns, they mean to restore slavery. Santonax was a bit uncertain as to what was taking place in France, but in regard to San Domingo, 50 years after, black slaves still remembered him because he had devoted himself completely to black emancipation.
But there was always this memory and this knowledge that there would be an attempt to restore slavery.
He had that, and he warned them. Anybody tells you to give up your guns, that means the restoration of slavery.
And so we come to many documents you have, your writings of Toussaint and others. Perhaps, I remember you reading the first part, the prologue. I've underlined something here of your writings, Toussaint's writings. The underlining, the question is, are the colonists aware now that the black people will never return to that?
Toussaint is writing to the French government, and he's warning them that the colonists are plotting to restore slavery. And he's telling the French government, I'm somewhat uncertain as to what you intend to do. So he's telling them, well, I don't think you will. It is a very fine passage. Do they think that men who have been able to enjoy the blessing of liberty will calmly see it snatched away? They supported their chains only so long as they did not know any condition of life more happy than that of slavery. But today, when they have left it, if they had 1,000 lives, they would sacrifice them all rather than then be forced into slavery again. And then he speaks here to the French government, but no, the same hand which has broken our chains will not enslave us anew. France will not revoke her principles. She will not withdraw from us the greatest of her benefits. He's telling the French government, you wouldn't do it, but I'm telling you not to do it. She will protect us against all our enemies. She will not permit her sublime morality to be perverted. Those principles which do her most honor to be destroyed, her most beautiful achievement to be degraded. But if to re-establish slavery in San Domingo, this was done, then I declare to you, it would be to attempt the impossible. We have known how to face dangers to obtain our liberty. We shall know how to brave death to maintain it. And then he ends up magnificently. This, citizens, directors, is the morale of the people of San Domingo. These are the principles that they transmit to you by me. Awfully was beautiful.
The eloquence. Oh, yes. And yet, wasn't this the one flaw in Toussaint, his faith in France? Come to Toussaint L'Ouverture's, possibly his one flaw, Dr. C.L.R. James, Professor James, our guest scholar, particularly on black, African, West Indian history, a reading talking about his book. It's a classic called The Black Jacobins, dealing with Toussaint L'Ouverture revolt beginning in 1791 in San Domingo. And he was just reading one of the letters Toussaint wrote to France. In a moment, we return to the theme and to Professor James. We return to Professor James, his book, The Black Jacobins. He'd just been reading a letter that Toussaint L'Ouverture wrote to the French government, and we continue.
A flaw. I admit that it was a flaw, but to see it only as a flaw is a mistake, because that enabled him to lay the foundation in San Domingo that Dessalines and these others were able to use. That he had a limit. But it was this limitation that enabled him to establish something which the others could use.
I withdraw that word flaw, because this again is part of the power of your book, the nature of paradox, the nature of limitation, the nature of human possibilities. This was Toussaint.
I would like to tell you something. For 100 years and more, Toussaint was somewhat ignored in the history of San Domingo. People looked upon Toussaint as having made mistakes, and Dessalines, the man who carried the revolution to success, which undoubtedly he did. My book was translated into French. It went to Haiti. And I have been told by many Haitians that today in Haiti, there is a new conception of the role of Toussaint in the revolution due to the what my book has said.
So because even though, as you say, he was tied to France very much,
yes,
this the nature of him, this enabled one of his colleagues, Dessalines,
to go further and enabled Toussaint to lay the foundation and to establish certain principles. The real mischief maker in that business was Bonaparte.
So now we come to Bonaparte misusing.
Bonaparte, who sent this tremendous expedition, perhaps the greatest expedition that had ever left Europe to conquer the Haitians, the blacks in San Domingo, and they failed.
You know, this is incredible. Again, the book and its 1969-70 counterparts. The greatest expedition to conquer an island. We think naturally of ourselves in Vietnam at the moment. But here it was, Leclerc led this incredible... Something happened to him, this French general, in his letters, his agony.
Yes.
Something he thought was easy, was a cinch.
Yeah, no.
And then something happened to him.
In the end, he says, we in France have a false idea of the country in which we fight and the kind of men we fight against. That was wrung out of him at the end. He realized that the blacks of San Domingo were not people whom you could just drive into slavery. He says, we don't understand these people. I remember many passages of his letters, but I remember this passage in particular. It is not enough to have taken away Toussaint. There are 2,000 leaders in San Domingo to be taken away.
And right there, even though Toussaint was betrayed, he returned to France, he was imprisoned and died in prison. He said so, yeah, that there were still others.
Yes, he said, you have in getting rid of me, you have taken away only the trunk of the tree, but its roots are deep, and slavery will never be restored in San Domingo. That must be remembered. Toussaint could take the chances that he did and tie himself to French civilization because he was absolutely certain that the slavery could never be restored.
And so it was 12 years or so.
Yes.
The French lost thousands, of course,
the blacks. They lost 60,000 men, and more than that, the historian of the British Army says that the British Army was destroyed in the Caribbean, totally destroyed. He says that is why when the war began in 93, they made little attempt or could do little in regard to France, in regard to the army, in regard to military invasion of France. The reason was because they were attempting to capture the West Indian territories of France, and the black armies destroyed the British Army completely. Fortescue, the historian of the British Army, says that 1798 is the most disgraceful year in the history of the British Army because those blacks in the San Domingo did what they did.
You know, your book has a never-ending possibilities because it occurs to me, the Black Jacobins, and of course the phrase deals with the French Revolutionary Party, the Jacobin Party, but also the role that the Toussaint L'Ouverture Revolution played in the American Civil War.
Now, not only that, I would prefer to say this. It is in regard to the independence of the Latin American countries, because they saw America independent. Good, they accepted that. But then they saw these black slaves not only win the independence, but keep it. Whereupon a lot of them in Latin America began to say, well, if they could win the independence and keep it, it isn't only America and a big country like it, so we can. And Pétion was beaten from Latin America, was welcomed in Haiti. He was given food. He was made better. Doctors attended him. And then they gave him men.
This was a Latin American.
Latin America, they gave him men. They gave him arms. They gave him money. They gave him a printing press. And it is from there he went back to Latin America to win the independence of the five states. So they took a tremendous part in the development of Latin America.
Of Latin America, and then, of course, here we come to the United States.
Because the people in the United States refused to recognize Haiti until after 1865. Because the southern slave owners were always looking upon that as somewhere where they could expand the territorial development of cotton, number one, and number two. San Domingo and Haiti had given an example to the French, to the blacks in the United States, which they knew very well, and which these southern plantation owners were mightily afraid of. That is a tremendous role.
You know, again, the contemporary aspects of your book, toward the latter part of it, the War of Independence, the last chapter, you speak of the pride of, in 3 years, people ask, how could this happen in 3 years? This, any part of your own writing there?
Yes. If in 1788 anyone had told the Comte de Lauzun, the minister, the Comte de Pinier, the governor, General Rochambeau, the soldier, Moreau de Saint-Méry, the historian, Barbé de Marbois, the bureaucrat, that the thousands of dumb brutes who were whipped to labor at dawn and whipped back at midnight, who submitted to their mutilations, burnings, and other savageries, some of whom would not even move unless they were whipped, if these fine gentlemen had been told that in 3 years the blacks would shake off their chains and face extermination rather than put them on again, they would have thought the speaker mad. While if today one were to suggest to any white colonial potentate that among those blacks whom they rule are men so infinitely their superior in ability, energy, range of vision, and tenacity of purpose, that in 100 years' time these whites would be remembered only because of their contact with the blacks, one would get some idea of what the counts, marquises, and other colonial magnates of the day thought of Jean-Francois, Toussaint, and Rigaud when the revolt first began.
Thus again, we come to the question of awareness and the lack of awareness on the other side of what is happening, of what is about to happen.
Yes.
The book again has this prophetic quality. It's 1938 first written.
And many of these things are written in 1938. I didn't write them in. I made one or two changes and introduced one or two new points. But essentially, 98% of the book is as it was. Now, I would like, if you don't mind, to read this. This is one of my favorite passages in the book. Yes. And you must remember that this was written in 1938. He had sent millions of francs to America to wait for the day when he would be ready to invade Africa, put an end to the slave trade, and make millions of blacks free and French, as the French Revolution had made the blacks of San Domingo. The great revolution had propelled him out of his humble joys and obscure destiny, and the trumpets of its heroic period rang ever in his ears. In him, born a slave and the leader of slaves, the concrete realization of liberty, equality, and fraternity was the womb of ideas and the springs of power which overflowed their narrow environment and embraced the whole of the world. But for the revolution, this extraordinary man and his band of gifted associates would have lived their lives as slaves, serving the commonplace creatures who owned them, standing barefooted and in rags to watch inflated little governors and mediocre officials from Europe pass by, as many a talented African stands in Africa today. I wrote that in 1938, and today I'm very proud of it, because I knew what was taking place. They were standing there in rags and having to wave when these fellows passed. Yes. And they only needed a few years for them to be driving past in charge, whatever they did, and these fellows became nothing.
It is amazing, your passage, that as well as your book, Professor James, the fact that you describe this, and toward the end of it you speak of a letter from a Rhodesian black that speaks of this particular aspect of it. Your writing, of course, the style, the power, but also the truth, that in this one man, then you saw the development of a people, too.
Yes.
And you spoke of the West Indians earlier, and of course the great poet, Aimé Césaire, whom you know.
Yes, I know Césaire, and he's a man I admire very much. And in the course of this appendix, in which I deal with the history of the West Indies, from Toussaint L'Ouverture to Fidel Castro, I refer to Césaire's great poem, Cahier d'un retour au pays natal, Statement of a Return to the Country Where I Was Born. And I've translated some of it, because it is in this poem that is first stated the poetic conception of negritude. He says, my negritude is not a stone, its deafness a sounding board for the noises of the day. My negritude is not a mere spot of dead water on the dead eye of the earth, My negritude is no tower, no cathedral. It cleaves into the red flesh of the teeming earth. It cleaves into the glowing flesh of the heavens. It penetrates the seamless bondage of my unbending patience. And then he makes a tremendous statement on behalf of African civilization. Hurrah for those who never invented anything, for those who never explored anything, for those who never mastered anything, but who, possessed, give themselves up to the essence of each thing, ignorant of the coverings, but possessed by the pulse of things, indifferent to mastering, but taking the chances of the world. And then he launches an attack on white civilization in 1938, the same year I wrote this book. And today, with all these missiles about, he says, listen to the white world. Its horrible exhaustion from its immense labors, its rebellious joints cracking under the pitiless stars, its blue steel rigidities cutting through the mysteries of the flesh. Listen to their vainglorious conquests, trumpeting their defeats. Listen to the grandiose alibis of their pitiful floundering. But he says, I must not be hate. I must not have hate. Because for it is not true that the work of man is finished, that man has nothing more to do in the world but be a parasite in the world, that all we now need is to keep in step with the world. But the work of man is only just beginning, and it remains to man to conquer all the violence entrenched in the recesses of his passion. And no race possesses the monopoly of beauty, of intelligence, of force. And there is a place for all at the rendezvous of victory. It is a magnificent poem. Oh, yes. It is the finest poem ever written on Africa.
You know,
he's a West Indian, too, I want to say.
Professor C.L.R. James, as you just read these excerpts from the César poem, I couldn't help but think of the power, the humanity of it, and, of course, of your book and your scholarship. The book, by the way, for listeners who will be inquiring, it's vintage. It's a paperback vintage. It's definitely available. It's a classic, and it should be read, it seems to me, by anyone who wants to know about the open window and what is going on in the world and what will continue. And perhaps just one as sort of a postscript, your own courses, the way you teach, manner. All literature uses your base in speaking of liberation. I know you use in one of your courses, Origin of Western Civilization, from the Bible of the Hebrews, Revolt of Colonial People, Exodus, Revolt of Women Against Second-Class Citizenship, Esther. And you go on to speak of Greek, use Greek classics.
Yes.
And you go on.
I use the Greek classics because the basis of Western civilization is the work of the Hebrews and of the Greeks. Everybody understands that. So in studying the race and the radicalism of race, I take examples of the radicalism of the Hebrews and the radicalism of the Greeks. I am happy to do the story of Moses because he was the first that we know of who led a suppressed people to freedom. So if you're talking about freedom and the release of a suppressed people, I begin with Moses. That is what we are rooted in, particularly in the United States and in the Caribbean. We are rooted in Western civilization. So we cannot ignore African civilization. We do the best we can to be in contact with it. That series of talks, I deal with Mau Mau, I deal with Nkrumah, etc., the emergence of Africa. But I say we have to be aware of where we have come from. We cannot deny the roots of Western civilization and the radicalism that we find in it. We absorb and take it to ourselves. So that I think we have a lot to learn because we both Western and African civilization, we of the black people in the Caribbean and in the United States, we touch civilization at two points. And in all my work, I try to be aware of them.
Yes, indeed, as also what Dr. Du Bois said in Soul of
Black Folk. Dr. Du Bois is one of the greatest men of the 20th century. I have been very hostile to people who talk about Dr. Du Bois as one of the great black leaders. And even black people say, well, he was one of our best. I say, by doing that, you denigrate him. Yes. He was one of the most distinguished citizens of the 20th century. Yes. Black, white, yellow, or anything. A remarkable man.
Yes. So in Dr. James, we have the scholar, at the same time, not the academician, not the removed, detached, very much the advocate scholar.
Yes, I'm the advocate, and wherever possible, I participate in the struggles of the people. I know, and my course is aimed at proving that without the conscious intervention, or even the unconscious intervention of the mass of the people, there can be no real progress towards liberation. The intellectual may express and make clear what is really taking place in the majority of the people. That is what my course is seeking to prove, and that is what my book, The Black Jacobins, expresses both for France and for the colonies.
Just as there are two cultures, just as you find the fusion of the two and the contributions of the black man to both tremendous, so you all see knowledge, you all see activity from the scholar, but from the street as well, the book and the street. You see it going both ways.
Together, and one expresses the other, and the work of the book is of no serious value unless it is supplemented and stimulated by the work of the street. That is the view I have.
The Black Jacobins is the book, and it's my privilege indeed to have been here with Professor C.L.R. James, now visiting professor at Northwestern University. It's a vintage, and thank you very much indeed.
Much obliged to you, sir. Much obliged to you.
This particular conversation took place on during Dr. James' last day in America. He's returning to his home in London. He'll be returning to America soon to lecture at Princeton, at Yale, and at Columbia, we trust, at Northwestern again, where he'd like to talk about the various literatures of history and liberation, Old Testament, New Testament, the Greeks. That was part of a series, too, at Northwestern. So we trust in the not-too-distant future, once more, Dr. James will be our guest. The book is The Black Jacobins, paperback, vintage, the publishers. We thought perhaps some music that might be appropriate now, in the time remaining. There are songs, slave songs and code songs sung in the islands, San Domingo then, and no doubt many of them found their way in America itself, in the States, in the pre-Civil War days. A Voodoo American is such a song. It is code, as black spirituals are code. It's a funeral song, Bia Baluco. At the same time, it speaks of freedom. And though it speaks of that body of water, when the burden of life becomes too much for the man who has died, there's a deep body of water separating him from freedom. So, as we say, this could be the River Jordan. It also could be that river separating slave from free state, or slave state from Canada. And these are songs that are commonly found today in the Sea Islands off the coast of Florida, Georgia, and South Carolina. It could be traced there, but I imagine could go back to the Caribbeans as well. This one, Voodoo American.